All right, we finally made it to Seawolf Park. It's a pretty cold morning this morning in Texas. According to the wind chill, coming down here in this Jeep, I was driving in 17 degree weather. Probably not bad in a car with a heater, but that's not what I was driving. I was driving this. Only one door, everything else is open. I feel like a gynecologist for a polar bear. But I need all you folks to stick around to the end of this video. Help me answer a question. Question that I don't really know the answer to. Maybe you do. Stick around. Help me find out. Mosquito. Well, there she is, friends. The historic USS Cavalla. Located in Galveston, Texas, at Seawolf Park. And I'm sure everybody that's watching this knows why she's historic, but let me tell you real briefly. She is the only U.S. submarine to have ever sank an enemy aircraft carrier all by herself. When she was built, she had 6 torpedo tubes to the front and 4 torpedo tubes in the aft. Here's you a quick rundown of the story. The captain was under direct orders to not engage enemy ships, but to report them. He ran across a fleet of several ships, including an aircraft carrier of the Shokaku class, and his crew, of course, wanted to fire on the aircraft carrier because they thought they'd never run across it again and never have another chance. But he followed his orders and he did not fire. He stayed submerged until it was safe to come to the surface and transmit the coordinates of the Japanese fleet. Later the next day, they ran into the same Japanese fleet again, and at that time they discovered that not only was it a Shokaku class aircraft carrier, but that it was the Shokaku herself. 3 Japanese destroyers had spotted the Cavalla and were closing in on her. The captain quickly ordered for a salvo of 6 torpedoes.
Fire everything we've got.
Yes, sir.
To be fired at a depth of 15 feet. The first 2 fired at periscope depth, and then the Cavalla started to dive as the Japanese destroyers were getting closer to her. So during the dive, the other 4 torpedoes fired at 8-second intervals. 3 explosions were heard, so 3 torpedoes hit their mark on the aircraft carrier, and 3 are still sitting at the bottom of the ocean somewhere. The aircraft carrier did sink, losing most of her crew. This is really rather exciting for me because this is a very historic event and a very, very important event in World War II. And this is the ship that did it. This ship and the men on it. Let's go take a look at the actual torpedo tubes that did the work. This ship is extremely large, much larger than I was expecting. In this circle, there's a plaque for each American submarine that was lost in World War II. And I believe it also tells how many of the crew were lost with the ship. This is the entrance, which again was originally a torpedo loading port. These are two of the six forward torpedo tubes. There are now only four, as in two were removed in a retrofit about 2 years after her launch. One of these torpedo tubes very likely could be one that fired or torpedo that sank the Shokaku. It's kind of weird standing in here. Imagining the men that were running around in here desperately trying to get these torpedoes loaded and fired, so desperately wanting to sink that aircraft carrier, which they did. But standing in here, you can imagine all the anxiousness and heart pounding that was going on. Just like every warship, smells of boiling grease in here. Kind of like it. Let's look at a few controls. Don't know what they do, but let's look. It is. The hatch is not very big at all. Outside, I said the submarine looked extremely large, which it did. In here, there's very little space. These hallways are about 2 feet wide. Bunk areas are very small. Hatch is maybe 40 inches tall. Won't move. Steampunkish, doesn't it? The men that worked in here definitely knew what they were doing and where everything was. This is evidently the dive room. Taking a guess, those of you that know something about submarines, let me know if I'm wrong, because I very easily could be. But there's an awful lot of valves, levers, and wheels in here. Whoever built this was a genius themselves. Hatch going somewhere, it's locked up. Sonar. Red dive light, or battle station light, I guess. It's a cold day today, like I said. There's a lot of people here, so I may have to narrate some of this later. Did not expect so many people to be here today. Up to bridge, periscope, and attack center. Let's see here. Dang it, they have it chained. Can't get in there. I know I was in there last time I was here, but that's been 20 years ago. Wish I could get up there, but not with that chain there. It ain't gonna happen. Dadgummit. I was looking forward to showing you a shot through the periscope. Looks like that's not going to happen. Everywhere you walk in this ship, there's switches, valves, garbage disposal. I guess it launched it out into the open sea. Would have had to. There's no place on this ship for storing garbage. Radio equipment, probably sonar. Just an unbelievable amount of controls in here. Look at those little bank of nozzles. Who knows what those do or did? Another red light. I'm sure those are battle station lights. Anybody that knows anything about submarines, though, add whatever you want in the comments, because when it comes to submarines, I love them, but I'm lost on knowledge of them. Well, not lost, because I never knew, so I can't lose what you never had. Kitchen area. Doesn't even have a blockade in front of it, so I can get in here. Plenty of headspace. I'm 6'1", and I've got probably 2 or 3 inches to spare before I get into pipes and valves and things, so pretty good headspace. It's just really a weird feeling. I don't know what word to use to describe it. It's a weird feeling being in here. knowing that at one time in history, men were running up and down these hatches, flying through them like they're probably not even there, and I can barely crawl through them given it time. I'm not going to have to add any music to this video, apparently, or very little. But it's hard to imagine the men running up and down these very narrow, very small hatches and hallways in emergency situations, especially when they saw this Shokaku. There had to be just a unreal amount of excitement in here. They were out on their maiden voyage, 20 days into their maiden voyage, I think, and got one of the biggest kills of the entire war. Bunks are obviously shoulder to shoulder, but in working in this environment, you would have had to be best friends with everybody on board. The hatch is so small. Let me see if I can show you how small. I'm sitting on the hatch, and my head is still bigger than the hatch. Getting through this thing in a hurry would be really tough. And again, I'm a 65-year-old fat man, so not fat, but you know, approaching fatness, let's say. But for a 18 to 20 something, 130 pounds, I imagine, fly right through it. So let's go through this thing. See where we're at. Yeah, that's that old man grunt. Engine room. Very dark in there. Look at that. They were ready to make their own repairs, which makes sense. You'd have to be, wouldn't you? Just an unbelievable amount of knowledge it would have taken to know what all this stuff does. That is looking like an air compressor. It's belt driven, whatever it is. See how many cylinders we got here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Is there another engine? Yes, there's another engine in the next compartment. So I'm assuming it's going to be the same size. So we're talking about 16 cylinders. Don't know what the diameter of them are, but they're big. Or are there other cylinders on the other side? Yes, there are. So we're talking about 16 cylinders on this one engine, 32 cylinders total. This is a big, big, heavy, heavy ship from the outside. But inside here, it's just unbelievably small. And more background music. More background music. I said, Bill, why did you act this way? Said, I won't admit the thing she gives away. Oh, we got more light in here. Oh, look at there, we got two engines in here. Is there two engines? No, there was only one engine in that other compartment. Two engines in here. So we're up to 48 cylinders total so far. Under the deck. My Lord. Unbelievable, the things in here. And I've been in here before, and it's still unbelievable. Destroyers and battleships have a lot of things in them too, but this is just unbelievable. No wonder we had so many engineers and, you know, smart people come out of World War II. More music. Don't know what that is. Check it out. It's probably air conditioner port, I'm gonna say. Yeah, I'm gonna say an air conditioner port. Goes up here, connects into that pipe, and then runs. Yeah, that's got to be something to cool the engine room down a little bit. Yeah, there's a evaporator core in there because a condensation pan right here leads into a copper tube to take the condensation out wherever it goes to. Hey, finally, one thing I know that it does, what it does. I wish I knew what all or any of this stuff does or did. Because it's absolutely amazing. Let's see if we can. Nope, don't move. They move out, but well, you can move that one a little bit. Nah. Engine order command panel. Had to be unbelievably noisy in here when those things are running. Let's flip some switches. Bummer. See if we can operate that. Look at there. At least we can give the engine some air. I know how to do that now. Oh. That mechanism locks it into place. I'm gonna assume that that's a dive bell. Let's try a few more switches. I know none of them gonna do anything, but that's a push button, but kind of fun messing with them, especially when you think about the men that actually used them. These are obviously hydraulics. Well, not obviously, but it looks like hydraulics for something. Anybody that knows anything about submarines, whether you served on one or not, give the rest of us some information on what some of this stuff is. Oh, Lordy, it's hard for an old man to get through those ports. Read that sign. Oops. Oh, look, these have power because they have lights. This is narrow. I have to turn. This is probably 14 inches wide. I have to turn sideways to get through here. And I want to know what's inside these cages here. I'm going to get through here and turn around so I'm facing the cages. Let's see if I can see what's in there. Oh, look at there. Can't wait to come back to that. Alright, what does it look like this in here? I can't make heads or tails out of none of that stuff. Looks like a bunch of electrical, transformers or something along that line is what it looks like. Oh Lord, I can't turn. All right. Down the lower deck somewhere. Once again, somewhere else we can't go, but just demonstrating how large this ship really is. And of course, more valves. All right. There. We all know what that is, I think. Don't know what it's called, but we know what it does. Engine speeds. Lord have mercy. Generator, battery, starboard motor, aft motor, aft battery. Can you imagine being in here, knowing this thing's going through the water, underwater, at about, I don't know, 15, 20 miles an hour? And not knowing what's in front of you in this big old, man, it's just unbelievable. World War II generation, as a whole, was an amazing generation. But the guys that served on these ships, they might just be a little grade above. That looks like something you could look through. I'm gonna look through it. And you know what there is through it? Not a thing. Switch says on that goes to it, but I bet that at one time let you see something. Who knows what? Look, we had a telephone here at one time. The cord is now just laying there, but that used to hold a telephone anyway. Oh, look, another. That one's turned off. Oh, it says it's an alarm. So maybe it's not something to look through. Maybe it's something that lights up red. I don't know if I'm going to try to look through it again. Nothing. All right, so on we go. Oh. All right, we've made it to the rear aft torpedo room. Look at the size of this thing. It's hard for you to tell, I know. Let me step it off. 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21. It's got to be at least 25 feet long. There's two of them there. There's four torpedo tubes. These are the aft torpedo tubes. None of these fired any of the torpedoes that sank the Shokaku. But there's no telling what else they did. Look at that conglomerate of, wow. Look at here. Got a fire trigger right there. That's awesome. I mean, that's awesome. I hope you can see that. That light is not exactly quite right. But that is awesome. Must be a fire control panel right there. And that's a fire trigger right there. That is awesome. The whole thing is awesome. But that fire trigger. Man, I just want to pull it. I gotta pull it. I'm gonna pull it. It pulls. Feels pretty good too, actually. That is awesome. Well, this ship is so small inside, I don't see how they could carry very many torpedoes. Of course, it's got a, I guess probably a, well, no, it's not an added floor. There would have had to have been a floor here. I guess they could have stored torpedoes underneath this somehow. There's room for four torpedoes. There are three torpedoes in here, which they're just hollow, of course. Or maybe not. I don't know. Hard to say. Let's check the prop out on one of them. Does not spin. Ooh, that sounds solid. That's solid. Hurts the knuckles too. Okay, it gets hollow right about there. So the engine part of it may very well be there, because that sounds really solid. And we've got bunks in here. Which I guess, with such little space, you'd have to have as many bunks for men to sleep as you could possibly squeeze in between everything else. This looks like a restroom here. Shouldn't call it the head since we're on a ship. Can't open it because it's, like everything else, is locked up. That looks important. Don't know what it is. It's a lever of some kind that's locked up into place. All right, let's exit. After we look at this, I didn't see this the first time around. It's round. And that's all I know about it. Well, I know that it's red. Who knows what that is? Let me know. Hit my head twice. That's pretty good, I think. To be up on these decks when this thing was out at sea would probably be quite an experience. Let's go see if we can get a little video of these aft torpedoes they have in the aft torpedo tubes, which are above ground and not blocked in by anything. They do have a couple display torpedoes, which I'm sure, again, are just hollow tubes. No motor, no innards at all, I'm sure. But kind of looks cool. Well, let's go get a little look-see at that. Walking up to the aft now, and once again there's the draft markings, and it's above 1 foot, so I don't know how much deeper it goes below that. So those forward torpedo tubes could be underground. It's a shame to hide them like that, though. If they are. Or even if they're covered up by steel. Well, I'm ashamed of myself. But I forgot to bring any more SD cards. The one I've got is filled up in the camera. So I'm going to have to supplement with my phone. Very, like I said earlier, very lengthy and pretty good size diameter. I think the specification is 21 inch in diameter, and it's every bit of that. Got a lot of rust going on back there, just like the USS Texas, unfortunately. But I guess that's happening to all these things. There's the door the torpedo would come out of. Got a lot of rust going on up there too. That's a shame. No way to stop it though. But I was gonna say over here, before my camera filled up the SD card on me, I noticed that that looks like there's been patches done back here. Definitely been patches done back here. That right there is not original. That right there is not original. It can't be. They wouldn't have done that. I'm sure originally that was one solid plate of steel. And look at the welds. Weld on top of weld on top of weld. And that's all throughout the ship. Down here to some plates that have not been messed with or replaced, or don't look like it anyway. And look at the welding. That is a wide weld. It's probably 1 inch wide. I don't know if that's welding stacked up on each other or just one big weld, but I feel like it's welding stacked up on each other, because there you can see the difference in the welding tracks. This right here? Don't know. Almost looks like a port of some type that's been sealed up. But it's welded the same way, so I'm sure that's original. And here we have a bunch of small holes. This one was square originally, it looks like. You can get you a better angle where you can see that squareness a little bit better. There we go. And that was sealed, and something round was sealed, or there's several of them here within a 10-foot stretch of each other. No idea what they were. Could they possibly be battle scars that were patched? I don't know. And what about this big area here? Why is that there? And what was it? Some of you submariners need to weigh in on this stuff. There's another patch right here. This is an obvious patch, to me anyway. I don't know if the Cavalla ever getting hit. Although, she did, well, I take that back. She did get damaged when the three destroyers depth-charged her after sinking the Shokaku. I know they dropped, well, I don't know how many torpedoes, but it was recorded that they recorded by the crew that they dropped anywhere between 106 and 119 depth charges. Because, after all, they're Shokaku, which was the name of the class, and they sank the aircraft carrier that class was named after. So they were hotter than hornets, I'm sure, to get this submarine. And I know they did some damage to her, so that may be what those patches are from. Out of the 106 to 119 depth charges that were dropped on her, 56 came within distance to do serious damage to her. And she was very lucky to have survived that. So those very likely could be from depth charge damages caused in that very attack, which is pretty amazing itself. Let's go look around the other side, see if we can find some more damages about in the same areas. All right, we're on the other side now. And there's not a sidewalk, so I don't know if I'm supposed to be walking here or not, but I'm not gonna hurt anything. So let's just sit, look and see if we can find any damages. Don't know what these things are, but they're really long. They're probably a third the length of the submarine. I don't know if they have something to do with the submarine or if they're just being stored here. No idea. They have no markings or no wording on them, so I don't know what it is. It's not big enough to hold torpedoes. No idea. Okay, I'm running into uniform size holes. They could be battle damage repairs, I guess. But they look too uniform in size to be that. But there's another thing that I'm not, and that's a welder or damage assessor. I'm neither one of those things. So I don't know what those spots are or what those spots could be. But I haven't seen any plates welded on the outside on this side like there was on the other. I think those plates on the other side are obvious battle damage. Yeah, there's a lot of uniformity to these, so that may be an original construction. And there's another small round one that may be battle damage. I'd love to know how thick that is. But that looks to be the only one on this side of the ship that could even closely be battle damage. That could be battle damage. It's got a square hole in the middle of it, but that may be because there was some kind of special plug or something that was used for it. This right here, no idea what this is. Not battle damage though, because there's a valve there or an opening. That may be to fill it with fresh water, who knows, could be anything. All right, we are at the end. There are some spots right there. They look uniform, but they could be battle damage. And just the same guy repaired them, and that's why they look uniform. Possibility, don't know. Y'all let me know. All right, let's get the drone in the air and see what this looks like from above.
And now it gives me great pleasure to present to you Captain James B. Castler, retired, who was a navigator of the Cavalla during the memorable scenes you have just witnessed. It's good to see you again, Jug.
Glad to see you, Admiral, and I must say I got a real kick out of reliving the Cavalla's first combat patrol.
Your leap year lady surely lived up to her lucky christening, didn't she?
I'm proud to say that she did.
That decision to pass up a perfect shot at that first carrier must have been an awfully tough one for your skipper to make.
Yes, he said it was just about the toughest he'd ever faced. It surely made us all unhappy at the time.
Well, it certainly paid off, not only in your sinking of Shokaku and possibly Albacore's getting tied whole, but in saving the lives of uncounted numbers of Marines and GIs on Saipan.
As you know, very few of our submarines were lucky enough to so much as see a carrier during the whole war. So when we had to pass our first chance, we were pretty sure there'd never be another.
Well, when the miracle did happen 2 days later, you certainly proved you were ready to handle it. Congratulations on a fine job.
Thank you, Admiral.
Restrooms available. Men.
Women.
Men. Women.
Women.
Men.
Women.
Men.
Out here in Galveston, you never know what you're going to run into. Somebody on a paddle boat fishing. A ferry boat. An old junker following the ferry boat. Or even a giant supply ship. Possibly a destroyer. Or even a submarine every now and then. Come to Galveston. Check it out for yourself. There's no telling what you'll see.
Okay, here's why I wanted you to stick around. Help me figure out what this is. I think I have figured it out, but there's no signs to tell you for sure. I think I know what it is. Let me know what you think. That right there. What is that thing? Has a hatch on the side. Has a hatch on top. Looks like it has a periscope. I've walked all the way around it. Can't figure out what it is. There's a conning tower sitting next to it. Not the conning tower off the Cavalla. Don't know where it's from. Give me your ideas what you think that is. And thanks for sticking around. I've had a great day out here at the USS Cavalla. It's absolutely an amazing ship. More amazing than I remember. And like I keep saying, it's been 20 years or so since I've been here. But it's an absolutely amazing ship. If you're ever in the area or live in the area and it's been a long time or you've never been to this submarine, man, you gotta come. You just gotta come. If you're a World War II buff, you got to see inside that thing. It's amazing. I hate that I had to finish out the video on my telephone. As a matter of fact, as soon as I leave here, I'm on my way to the store to buy a bigger and maybe a couple of more SD cards. This won't happen again anyway. The feeling I got in that ship, I think most World War II buffs would get inside that ship. I can't explain it, it's just weird. I really enjoyed being in there today. I enjoyed taking you folks along with me too, and I'm sorry I had to finish out the end of this video on my telephone. But I'm glad you stuck around to the end of it, and I appreciate that. Like I always say, it's been a Jeep, a drone, and an old man. We'll be seeing you next time. Do I need to cut that fingernail or what? And that's a real pair of jeans when you've had them so long you've worn them out. Close my book. Like you, let's see there. See there? It did not fire. Now, did I get a defect?
Has a little hint of chicken. He wants to eat it right out of my mouth. Which I'm going to let.
Hey, pass it aside. Try to back up a little bit.